The history of the church goes like this. After Christ founded the church, it was only one faith. Although there were heresies, there were those who broke off. But there was a major break somewhere in the mid-centuries, in the year 1054, when the Oriental churches broke away. When I say Oriental churches, I'm referring to the Orthodox, because some Oriental churches are united with the Pope, no? But later na lang dumating yung because of the seclusion. Now, yung we say schismatic, meaning may break. They do not recognize the Pope as the primus inter pares, the first among equals. I think you got this last week, no? Papacy. Okay. So the Pope is the primus inter pares. He is the Bishop of Rome para sa mga mga Orthodox. He is only the Bishop of Rome and he has no jurisdiction outside of Rome. He's just like any other bishop. But as Pope, he is the first among equals. He is the steward. Di ba? Tu es Petrus, et in quo Petra. Di ba? You are Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church, and the gate of hell will not prevail against it. So, there was a break, but we're not going to talk about the Greek Orthodox here. They have seven sacraments. They have the same number of books as we have in the Bible. In fact, we can go to, with the bishop's permission, we can receive the sacrament, we can receive communion from them upon permission of the bishop. Yun lang, baka hindi ka bigyan if they find out that you're Catholic. Okay, okay, we go on. We're more concerned here about the Western break, which is the Protestant faction, separated brethren. So, Christianity became generic. Paano nag-umpisa yon? As of the present time, there's about 38,000 plus and dividing. Yep. Natatandaan niyo sa biology niyo, amoeba, hindi tingnan mo sa microscope, nagdi-divide. And it's they like that, they keep dividing. They have that generic tendency to divide, to protest. And we will see, we're going to see that in the talk. And divergence in doctrinal tenets, iba-iba yung mga doktrina nila, they have something of this, meron ako na noon, wala ako noon, meron ako nito, siya meron noon. So, iba-iba sila. They have different doctrinal beliefs, no? But they're united only in sola fide, sola scriptura, which was our talk 2 weeks ago, the one I gave. Okay, so, this is the decree on ecumenism. Unitatis rede tegregato gratio by the Second Vatican Council. The restoration of unity among Christians is one of the principal concerns of the Second Vatican Council. Christ the Lord founded one church and one church only. Upon this rock, I will build my church. Hindi niya sinabi, I will build my churches. Upon this rock, I will build my church. However, many Christians' communions present themselves to men as the true inheritors of Christ Jesus, all indeed profess to be followers of the Lord, but differ in mind and go their different ways, as if Christ himself were divided. Such division openly contradicts the will of Christ, scandalizes the world, and damages the holy cause of preaching the gospel to every creature. If you look at the world today, there's so much trouble. There's so much division. And division is the cause of Satan's works. Christ wants everybody to be united. God created a united world, but Satan wants to divide creation. And even for the best intentions, nagdi-divide yung mga tao, di ba? Okay, so you promote Christian unity with dialogue and charity, prudence, humility, and patience. And then, articulate the church unity as proclaimed, attested by scripture and tradition with patience. Sabi ni St. Peter, 1 Peter 3:15, sabi niya, always be ready to give a reasoned explanation for the hope that is in you, but do it with love, with charity. Have a genuine concern for them. You pray for them. Acknowledge that they're also Christians, that they also have the faith. You know, we have more in agreement with them than what divides us. Unfortunately, may animosity minsan eh. Because of the little, we can have maybe 90% you know, we're sharing 90%. Yung division siguro mga 10% lang, and yet there's animosity. We refrain from prejudicial views and hostilical and inimical polemics. Have a brotherly dialogue and follow up. During my last talk with you, I talked to you about the pastor who approached me in a restaurant. Tapos sinabi niya, "Are you Catholic?" I said, "Yes, I'm Catholic. Thank you." So I said a silent prayer to the Holy Spirit. Sabi, "Ito na." And then sabi niya, "Will you go to heaven? Are you saved?" Sabi niya. So I said, "Yes, I'm saved. Thank you very much. But as to going to heaven," sabi, "I leave it to the grace and mercy of God." But before he could take off again, before he could fire another question, I asked him, "What about you? Will you be saved?" "Yes, I'll be saved," sabi niya. And you remember the course of that kwan, di ba? Naikwento ko na sa inyo, naisalaysay ko na sa inyo. And we ended on when he said, "Is Mary the mother of God?" Because he explained salvation to him, and he couldn't get off the ground anymore. And he decided to cambio siya. He changed his tune. "Do you believe that Mary is the mother of God?" And I can explain to him everything, all the way up to explaining the verses of scripture on the salutation of the angel, Elizabeth's greeting of Mary, which is also found in different words in 2 Samuel chapter 6 verses 2-9, where David says to himself, "Why is it that the ark of my Lord should come to me?" Nun padating niya yung ark of the covenant. And Elizabeth says the same thing. "Why is it that the mother of my Lord should come to me?" Where was Elizabeth? She was in the where was Mary? She was in the same hill country where David was. How long did Mary stay there? 3 months. How long did the Ark of the Covenant stay with David in 2 Samuel chapter 6 verses 2-9? 3 months then. So pinaliwanag ko sa kanya. I went to Genesis 3:15 as Mary is the woman, Mary at Cana, the woman at Cana, and the woman at the foot of the cross, and woman at Revelation. Pinaliwanag ko lahat yan. Then he said to me, bago siya tinapik at tuminalis, ang dami ko pa sinabi sa kanya, sabi niya sa akin, "You know a lot about the Bible," sabi niya. "Of course," sabi ko, "I'm Catholic." So with that, we ended. Now, I made a mistake there. Saan ako nagkamali? I did not follow up. Sana man lang kinilala ko siya. "Who are you? May I know your name? Can we talk again? Can we meet?" So there I was, parang may sense of victory, sense of pride. Oh, dead man na siya. Tameme siya, hindi na siya nagsalita. No. Apologetics is never like that. Once you have that edge, once you get going, then you follow up. Pwede ba kita, pwede mag-usap, pwede ulit tayo mag-usap. That is apologetics. That's being ecumenical. You want to share more of the faith with him. Kasi nanalo ka na, tapos na yung boxing. No. You're friends. He's your brother in the faith. And when you dialogue with them, you learn more of yourself also and of your faith in the manner that you deal with them. Well, let's go on. Okay? So, follow up. Huh? Have a spirit of dialogue. Always be prepared, sabi ni Peter. And it is the duty of every Catholic to proclaim the faith. St. John Paul, Pope St. John Paul II, said in Tertio Millenio Innuente, his letter, his apostolic letter, sabi niya, "Put to the deep, duke in altum, put out to the deep for a catch," which you find in chapter 5 of the Gospel of Luke. Put out to the deep for a catch. And all of us Catholics must know our faith. Dapat alam natin yung pananampalataya natin so we can share it. We must know our faith not to downgrade other Christians, but to be more brotherly and to have that spirit of unity. Maybe I can go on later with that in the last talk on how to do apologetics in your graduation. So let's go on. Let's go to the history. Okay. We studied this. We took this up in our previous session. The influence, the circumstances that contributed to the break of Christianity in the Western Church. Okay, Eastern Schism, yung mga influences, the Crusades. We'll go back to the Crusades later. The Black Death, Western Schism. This was already taught to you in History of the Church. Okay, next. Also in Sola Fide, Sola Scriptura, I mentioned Luther, because of he was scandalized by the sale of indulgences by some priests in Germany, he tucked in 95 theses on the Cathedral of Wittenberg, and he was stubborn in refusing to retract 37 points in what he had written. Ayaw niya palitan kasi naisulat na niya. Although 26 of those of what he had written, 26 or something like 30 plus, were also in defense of the Pope. At that time, Luther was not yet. He was not yet pushed to sola fide and sola discus. So, because of the late response and extreme, you know, polemics, yung arguing, debating, nagkaroon ng division. And then politics came in. The nobles wanted to gain the church lands. Gusto nila i-usurp yung church lands, mapakanin sa pagkanila na. And then the rest is history. Okay. So, because of the divergence in Christian unity, ano sinabi ng mga kwan, mga reformers? They were concerned because Luther was saying something, and then here comes Zwingli. Iba na naman sinasabi ni Zwingli. So, and then of course the parallels of Calvin later on. So they decided to meet in the city of Marburg in Germany. They drew 15 principles, doctrinal principles. Pag-usapan natin, dapat united tayo. Hindi pwede na we break away from the Pope and then all of a sudden, magkakawatak-watak tayo. We have to be united because Christianity must be united. Sabi na, because they, at that time, they no longer considered the Catholic Church as Christian or as faithful to the teachings of Christ. So sabi na, so they agreed on 14 out of 15 doctrinal principles. Nagkaiba sila sa Eucharistia. Did you take this up in Eucharist? Kay Luther, the real presence is a consubstantiation, contrary to the Catholic doctrine of transubstantiation. Sabi nga ni St. Augustine, when the words of Christ are said over the species of bread and wine, the substance is transformed into his body, blood, soul and divinity. Wala, hindi na yon, hindi na kwan. That is already the substantial Christ. It is no longer bread and wine. It will taste like bread. It will taste like, smell like wine. It will feel like wine. Lahat. It smell like wine. It smell like bread. Pero hindi na bread yon. That is already the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. Sabi ni kwan, sabi ni Saint Augustine, sola fide sufficit. Faith alone suffices to believe that the Eucharist is the body of Christ, body, blood, soul. That is the only time that St. Augustine says it, sola fide sufficit. Faith alone suffices that to believe that the Eucharist is the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. So consubstantiation kay Luther. When you receive communion, the presence of Christ is with the bread and the wine. There's no change in the bread and the wine, pero nandun yung presente yung Panginoon doon. Yung real presence is there. After the liturgy, bread pa rin yun, wine pa rin yun. Pwede mo itapon na yung tinapoy or the leftover wine you can throw away. Para sa kanila, it's not wine, it's not bread. So nothing has changed. Christ is there. Kay Calvin, well, let's go to Zwingli first. Kay Zwingli, sabi niya, memorial lang yun. Memorial, because Jesus said, do this in memory of me. A memory on what? Sabi niya, yung bread and wine, mga simbolo lang yun. Symbol. So, now, Calvin tried to bridge the disagreement between Luther and Zwingli. Para sa kanya, it's a mystical communion. It's a mystical communion on the symbols and on the memorial. The Anabaptists rejected it altogether. Sila sino yung Anabaptist? The Anabaptist was a radical group. Ito mga radical reformists na tinawag na nag-umpisa sa Switzerland. They were influenced by Zwingli, and para sa kanila, si Zwingli was still close to the Catholic Church. Kasi Luther, Calvin, and Zwingli believed that infant baptism should be practiced. Ito mga Anabaptists sabi na, you have to be an adult before you can profess your faith. Di ba mga born again, ganyan-ganyan? You have to be an adult before you can profess your faith and accept Jesus as your Savior. So, you must be baptized again. Ibig sabihin ng Anabaptist, to be baptized again. So if an infant was baptized as a child, paglaki niya, he has to be baptized again as an adult. And that is where he'll profess that he accepts Jesus as his personal Lord and Savior. Kaya Anabaptist ang tawag sa kanila. They rejected the Eucharist. So ito yung four major Protestant groups in the year 1529. Okay? Before Luther died, ilan na sila? Naging 75 sila before Luther died. And then now, there are about 30 to 40,000. Now, because of the policies of the nobility, yung nagkakaroon ng gera, ano, yung mga the dukes, the earls, and the lords, they decided na in order to maintain peace, sinabi nila doon sa Diet of Speyer, again in Germany, that the noble or the earl or the duke of an area cannot force his subjects to accept Lutheranism. Kaliwa, yung prinsipe doon sa isang lugar, naging Lutheran o naging Reformist at yung mga subjects niya, the common tao, were Catholic, hindi niya pwedeng obligahin yung mga tao niya na tanggapin yung tinuturo ng mga Reformers. Nagprotesta sila. Because of that protestation of theirs, the word Protestant came about. First, it was applied to the Lutherans, and then eventually to all protesters. Because eventually, yung mga nagpo-protesta kay Luther, tinawag na rin ng Protestant. So now you have the name Protestant to call them. In fact, sometimes in my Bible classes, I hear the term, ay, yung kaibigan ko naging Christian. Because they call themselves, those mga born again, those outside the church, they leave the church and they say, you ask them, ano ba yung kwan mo, yung following mo? Christian. They just say Christian, generic. So sometimes some Catholics say, naging Christian. But Catholic is Christian. I remember there was a dinner and yung may matalik na kaibigan yung kwan, yung kaibigan ko, and his wife was there, and the mothers of the children who went to the same school were there also. Nalaman ko yung tatlong kwan doon, yung tatlong kaibigan niya na matalik, puro kwan, born again. Puro asawa ng mga pastor. And then a fourth one arrived, and then was introduced to me, and I said, oh, you're also the husband of a pastor. I mean, your husband is also a pastor. And sagot niya, yes. As a matter of fact, I am the only Christian in the family. Really? Sabi ko, ano yun iba? The others are Catholic. Sabi. So sinabi ko, the Catholic Church is the two Christian churches. Then I felt somebody kick me under the table. Not to start. But I wasn't going to let that go. Di ba? So in the Diet of Augsburg, Lutheranism was rejected, again further rejected by even the other Protestants, and what happened was kumalat na in the term Protestant. So, by 16th century, Christianity was divided, iba-iba na sila, polarized, magkakaibang grupo na sila, and politicized, kasi yung mga ibang mga prinsipe, mga duke, mga earl, yung ganyan, nagkampi-kampihan na sila sa mga, kung ano yung sinusundan nila. And then wars for religion started due to politics. Okay? And those wars were, some of them wanted to get the church lands kasi maraming lupa ng simbahan. Next. And so, the main Protestant traditions at that time were Lutheran, Calvinist, Zwinglian, and Anabaptist. Now we have gone through that. Ito yung 75 denomination sects. And by the end of the century, there were 200 definitions of this is my body, this is my blood. In iba-iba na yung interpretasyon nila. Whereas before, it was only simply you believe it's the body, blood, don't still be in the Lord Jesus. Marami ng pasikot-sikot pag-explika kung ano yung Eucharistia. Okay, we go on. So, the Catholic, the faith framework of the church is, the Catholic Church is, you have the magisterium. The magisterium is the teaching authority of the church. The bishops together with the pope, united, in unison, in the same boat. You see that in the miraculous catch of fish. Diba? There were seven in the boat. Whose boat was it? Peter's boat, the boat of Peter. Sabi niya, we're going to go fishing. I'm going to go fishing, sabi ni Pedro. And the other apostles say, we're going with you. You find this in the, I think it's John 21, the miraculous catch of fish. Okay? So, magisterium. You see, there are seven of them in the boat. Seven is a complete number. That means they were all in unison. Where? They were all in unison in the same boat as Peter. So, all the bishops in the same boat as Peter, that's the magisterium, the teaching authority of the church. Because the bishops are also infallible, provided they're in unison with the teaching of the Holy Father, the Pope. You had this in your last session, no? Sacred tradition. What is the sacred tradition? That's the oral tradition of the church that gave us the doctrines and that gave us the mass and that gave us eventually sacred scriptures. 73 books. Liturgical, it's in the church. The life of the church. Oral. So, sabi ng Dei Verbum, Vatican, the second Vatican. Sacred tradition and sacred scripture comprise the sacred deposit of the faith entrusted to the magisterium. So you have three legs. Like that camera over there has three legs, yung tripod, tatlo. Pag inalis mo isang leg, matutumba yan. It will be unstable. The Protestants stand only in one leg. 66 books. Kung isa lang yung paa mo, matutumba ka yan, di ba? So three legs. It's more stable. So magisterium protects and safeguards the faith from false teaching. And it is the only one, the magisterium is the one that teaches the faith according, in unison with the Holy Father, the Pope, and you have the guarantee of the Holy Spirit, yung Espiritu Santo, na hindi mali yung turo ng Iglesia Katolika. Sacred tradition, that is the apostolic tradition, the oral tradition, where you have the liturgical and the doctrinal, yung mga tinuro over the past 2,000 years, where the doctrine, where the Bible, where the teaching has been explained in by the church, and of course sacred scriptures. Sa Protestant tradition, it is only sacred scripture. Wala silang magisterium. Para sa akin, I have the Bible and the Holy Spirit with me. So if I disagree with my pastor, I'll just close my Bible, go to the next room, I will form my own church. Divide. So we go on. And the theology of justification, I covered this in our last talk. If there's any question, you want me to go through it again? We're saved by only by grace. Okay? And the acceptance of the grace of Jesus Christ, when we accept His grace, when we allow His grace to work in us, then we can have faith and good works. We can respond in faith and good works. Faith and good works are inseparable. I think we discussed this already the last time. And the process is election, justification, and glorification. We're justified, and it's a process of sanctification. I have been saved, I am being saved, I will be saved. It is an ongoing process of sanctification. Sabi ng Panginoon, be holy as your heavenly Father is holy. So, pag sinabi, I have been saved, saved na ako once and forever. I heard some of you, I think, got some sa USB, yung Protestantism's Big Lie. May kumuha, nabasa ba niya? Sabi niya isang pastor doon, I have been saved by Christ. So, if I sin tomorrow and I continue sinning until the day I die, I will still go to heaven because I have already been saved. The apologist Steve Ray, who came here and he's coming here this coming year, 2017, that is a very dangerous doctrine because it's going to send many people to hell. And in our last session, I told you already how the process of salvation is. Later, if you want it repeated, sa Q&A na lang, no? Yung process of sanctification and the Bible verses. So, sa Protestant, sola gratia, faith alone, justification, wala na yung election nila is the justification. Wala na yung glorification, wala na yung sanctification. It depends on what sect or denomination it is. So we go on. In the theology of the Protestant, original sin, okay, let's go to the Catholic first. Original sin is a deprivation of grace. Grace has been, when Adam and Eve were created by God, they were grace-filled, but they failed the test. Anong nangyari when they failed the test? What happened? They lost the grace. So damaged sila. Kaya lang, there's transformation through grace. Pwede yung kwan, the damaged person, the descendants of Adam, can be redeemed and brought back to a sanctifying kwan, a sanctified form by grace. And how is this done? Through baptism. I think you took this up in kwan, sacraments of the church, di ba? Baptism. Baptism removes the stain of sin, removes sin altogether. You become a Catholic, then you be baptized. Baptism removes sin. It saves you. Sabi nga ni San Pedro, baptism now saves you. And then at Pentecost, when the people said, what must we do after Peter gives his first papal exhortation? They were speaking in tongues and the people said, oh, ito, naiintindihan natin. We come from different areas and then we understand it. These guys are Galileans and yet we can understand them in our own languages. And there were 15 nations there. Those 15 nations were the Jews of the diaspora. They came from different parts of the world for the Jewish feast of Shavuot, which is Pentecost. And yet, sabi na, naiintindahan natin. And then they said to Peter, Peter talks to them about Jesus Christ, and then he quotes from the prophet Joel, and then they say, what must we do in order to be saved? Ano siya nabi ni San Pedro? Accept Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior? No. It's there in the scriptures. What does it say? Repent and be baptized, every one of you. Repent and be baptized. And then in his letters, he says, baptism now saves you. So baptism saves you. But baptism does not remove the concupiscence. Ano yung concupiscence? The tendency to sin. Pag naging Katoliko ka, when you're baptized, you are cleansed of your sin. Okay? But the tendency to sin, that is the fallen nature of man. You have to fight concupiscence. That's why salvation is an ongoing process. That is why St. Paul says, work out your salvation with fear and trembling because you can lose it. In 2 Philippians 2, verse 12, sabi niya, work out your salvation with fear and trembling. And then in also in 1 Corinthians 9, he says, an athlete trains his body for an event. I train my body also, sabi niya, like an athlete. He trains himself, his spiritual life. Otherwise, I, who have preached the faith, might be lost or might be disqualified. So you can lose it. And in 1 Corinthians chapter 4, verses 3 to 5, sabi, I do not judge myself. I do not judge myself before the time. It is the Lord who looks into my heart. It's the Lord who looks into the heart. It's the Lord. I do not judge myself before the time. What time? The time of judgment. Because there's only one judge. So you cannot say, I have been saved, because you're rendering a judgment to yourself. Na you're canonizing yourself as santo ka na, di ba? So, the sacramental life is yung sanctification. So, the sacramental life keeps us in that state of fighting what? Fighting concupiscence. Sabi ni St. Paul, put on the armor of Christ. Kay Luther, total and absolute deprivation of grace. When Adam and Eve committed sin, wala na, tapos na. Gibang-giba na yung kanila. Human nature was totally corrupted. So, the only way that man could be saved was through Jesus Christ covering up the person with His grace. Sabi nga ni in the writings of Luther, sabi niya, man is like a dung heap. Diba? Dung heap, yung if you go to a place where there's cattle, tinatambak yung mga ebak ng baka doon, and covered by snow during winter, so it's white as snow, sabi niya. So, ganyan yung kwan, ganyan yung grasya ng Panginoon. Our sinfulness, our wretchedness, yung pagkabulok natin is covered by the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ. Covered. Pero underneath, bulok pa rin yun. Sabi naman sa Revelation, nothing unclean can come before the throne of God. So if you're merely covered, but deep inside there's no transformation, you cannot be saved. And then he removed, of the seven sacraments, he removed first apat. He retained confession, then after a while, inalis din niya yung confession. Sabi niya, only baptism and Eucharist are the sacraments instituted by the Lord. And as a matter of fact, we said earlier, yung Eucharist para sa kanila is a consubstantiation, and then there were other teachings. And baptism, para sa kanila, baptism is the acceptance into Christian life. Okay, later on that will still transform into baptism is merely, if you have already accepted Jesus Christ by faith, yung baptism mo is only a ratification of your acceptance that Jesus Christ is your Savior. Ordinance ang tawag nila doon. Ordinance. Okay, we go on. So, the just shall live. So, everything is entirely God's work. There's nothing that man can do in order to, totoo nga naman yun, there's nothing that we can do on our own without the grace of God. Pero para sa kanila, on our own, and the grace of God does not work in us kasi bulok tayo, we cannot even accept the grace of God kasi we're totally damaged. So, he believed that there are two kingdoms, the law and the gospel. The earthly is secular government, and you find that in Romans where St. Paul says that we should respect secular government, but at the same time, we promote righteousness among the seculars. You know, that promotion of righteousness is accepting Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior and living by the gospel, which is also true. Which is true. And he believed in the priesthood of all believers. Tayong mga Katoliko, what do you say this? The priesthood of all believers, we also believe the same thing. Where did he get this? From the Catholic Church, because he, Augustinian prior siya. We are all priests. Lahat tayo ay pare. What is a priest? A priest is the one who offers sacrifice. A priest is the one who mediates before God. But our understanding of priesthood as Catholics, there are two types of priesthood. The sacerdotal priesthood set aside for liturgy, liturgia, like the Levites in the Old Testament. Yung mga kaparean natin, sila yung fulfillment ng Old Testament priesthood, the Levites. And tayo naman yung secular priesthood, the priesthood of the laity. So, when you go to Mass, the one who is celebrating is Jesus Christ. Siya yung main celebrant. Mali yung sinasabi ng ibang mga lector na, let us now welcome our celebrant. The celebrant is Jesus Christ. Ano yung pare? Siya yung presider. He presides in behalf of Christ, and Christ will be in him. Yung in persona Christi. Diba? Okay, so, what about us? We are also priests. How do we share in that priesthood? Siya yung sacerdotal ministry. Siya yung representing Christ. And we, as a priesthood of the laity, we also offer sacrifice. That is where we bring our offering. Ano yung offering natin? We offer our brokenness. We offer our intentions. We offer everything. Maliban dun sa pagdaan ng collection box, maglalagay kang 10,000. Maliban dun hindi yan. We offer our prayers. And who do we offer our prayers to? To the priest? No, the priest only represents Christ. We offer it to Jesus Christ. Through Him, with Him, in Him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit. And when you say in the unity of the Holy Spirit, that's the entire church. The church in heaven, the choirs of angels, from Mary all the way to the least known saint. And all the saints in heaven, the communion, that's the communion of saints na sinasabi. Through Him, with Him, in Him. We offer our prayer. So it's a very powerful prayer. The Mass is the perfect prayer. Kasi it's Jesus Himself offering the Mass. It's Jesus Himself. It's a memorial of His Last Supper. It is not only a memorial of His Last Supper, it's also a memorial of His sacrifice on the cross. That's why we call the Mass a sacrifice, which the Protestants don't agree with. Kayo mga Katoliko, sinasakripisyo nila si Jesus araw-araw sa simbahan. Tapos linagay pa ninyo sa krus. Pinago uli ninyo sa krus. Hindi ninyo inalis sa krus. Linagyan pa ninyo na sa taas ng inre. Ano ba yung ibig sabihin ng inre? Sabi isang Katoliko na hindi masyadong catechized, Ilocos Norte Region 1. So, there is a spiritual hierarchy. He rejects that there's a spiritual hierarchy. Although Luther accepted a hierarchical clergy. Bakit? Because meron silang liturgia. We'll go to the liturgy. And the temporal is the laity. So the spiritual is the hierarchy, yung mga obispo nila, yung mga pastor nila, kaparehan. Yung temporal, yung the flock, the congregation. Maliwanag? Okay, next. Now, the other reformers were Melanchthon, Zwingli, and Calvin. Si Melanchthon was very intelligent, no? He was the one who formulated the Protestant doctrine, the Augsburg Confession, practically written by Melanchthon. Kaya lang hindi siya masyadong kilala. So he's so closely associated kay Luther, and yet Luther is the one who takes the banner, okay? Because he started the Reformation. He is the one who first rejected transubstantiation. And he was unyielding on sola scriptura, but okay with your battery is low. He rejected yung papal jurisdiction to some extent. In other words, he agreed that the Pope should have some sort of jurisdiction. Kaya lang, yung modelo nila is the Pope does not have jurisdiction overall. Some parts lang. Because para sa kanila, the Catholic Church is still Christian. Para sa kanila. Okay? So iba tayo sa Catholic Church, sabi niya. So ano sinasabi niya? As a matter of fact, Melanchthon was always the representative of the Protestants in dialogues with the Catholic Church. Siya lagi. Eventually, and he believed on the efficacy of good works. Luther was not too much into good works, but si Saiko naman, si Melanchthon, sabi niya, okay then yung good works. But then to them, to the reformers, the good works mean nothing. It only means it's a ratification of your faith. Kasi faith alone sila. So, sabi nga ng isang pastor sa akin, tsaka na yung works. Tsaka na yung good works. Faith lang. Kasi pag may faith ka, susunod na yung good works. Ay sabi ko sa kanya, sabi ni James, faith, for a man is justified by works, by good works, and not by faith alone. And that is the only time in the Bible, that's the only place in the Bible that you find alone following faith. So, hindi niya sabi niya sa akin, wag na tayo kay James, kay Paul lang tayo. Sabi ko, bakit? Yung Biblia, nasa Biblia yun eh. He had no answer then. Ano, you're going to throw, as a matter of fact, si Luther called the Epistle of James an Epistle of Straw. An Epistle of Straw. Ano yung straw? Yung pwede mo itapon pagkatapos ng kan. Diba? Epistle of Straw. Sino naman si Zwingli? Zwingli was from, hindi niya nakikita. Zwingli was a reformer also from Switzerland. Okay? Ito from Germany. In fact, when he died, he was buried beside Luther's burial crypt. Si Zwingli was Swiss, and he is called the father of Reformed theology. Ano ibig niya sabihin? He started the Reformation of the Reformation, or the reform of the Reformation. Para sa kanya, Luther did not go far enough. Katoliko pa yan si Luther. So may mga ideya din siya na dapat ganito. So what did he do? He started ideas of unconditional election, yung predestination. Since we cannot do anything about yung free will natin has nothing to do with our salvation, therefore it is God who will choose who will be saved. And Calvin brings it to its full meaning or its full development. So we go to Calvin now. Zwingli started it, but Calvin perfected that doctrine. Let's go to Zwingli. Next slide. Peter, can you please? Ikaw na magman ng kwan. Okay. Calvin's Reformed theology, okay, soli Dei Gloria. That is how you're justified. To God is the glory. Minsan naririnig natin yung mga pinsan natin, kaibigan, kumadre, kumpadre, pamangkin, na nag-born again, sasabihin, to God be the glory. Paborito nila yan, to God be the glory. That's Reformed. There's absolutely no glory that can be attributed to man. It's only God alone. Only God is glorious. Para kay Calvin, there is nothing glorious in man. Man cannot achieve holiness. Bulok yung tao. Dapat impyerno na. But because God chose him to be a member of the elect, then he is justified. Yung predestination yun. And he gave greater emphasis to the Old Testament. Yung mga, like, yung graven images. Mga, kayo mga Katoliko, nagsasamba kayo ng mga ribulto. Yan, mga ganyan, di ba? Up to now, we have those separated Christian brethren telling us that it's in the second commandment. If you look at the Ten Commandments, by the way, when we go to the commandments, there are two forms of the Ten Commandments. In the Eastern Church, formulated by St. Jerome, the father of the church in the Eastern Church, who translated the Bible into Latin, yung numbering niya ng Ten Commandments is 1-4, God. And then 5-10, yung social commandments, neighbor, huh? Okay. Kay St. Thomas, kay St. Augustine, father of the Western Church, it is 1-3, God, 4-7, 4-10, the social commandments. Alin ang tama? Pareho yung tama. The Eastern Churches, the Orthodox, go by this. And many Protestants go by this. The Catholic Church goes by this. And also the Lutherans. The Lutherans also go by this. Ano yung pinagkaiba ng kay St. Augustine at yan kay St. Jerome? Kay St. Augustine, di ba, first commandment, I am the Lord thy God, thou shalt not have strange gods before me. Ganon din kay Juan, kay St. Jerome. Kaya lang kay St. Jerome, yung second commandment sa atin, second commandment, thou shalt not take the name of the Lord thy God in vain. Sa kanya yung second commandment, third commandment yon. Para sa kanya, thou shalt not make any graven images of any kind, of anything, ganito, ganito, ganyan. Okay? So, dapat kung ganyan, nagdagdag siya ng isa dito. Kasi sa in the Augustinian compilation of the Ten Commandments, I am the Lord thy God, thou shalt not have strange gods before me. Kasama nandun yung making of images. And if you go by the Ten Commandments in Exodus, and if you go by the Ten Commandments in Deuteronomy, pag binilang mo, 14 yan. That's 14, it's not 10. But why do we say it's 10? It's the Decalogue. Why 10? Because the others are merely explanations of the other commandments. May overlap, nagkaka-overlap. That's why when St. Augustine formulated the Ten Commandments, tatlo lang yung sa Panginoon. The rest are social commandments. Yung sumunod, kay St. Jerome, he added the images. Now, if you look at the Orthodox Church, wala naman silang images. That's why they don't have images. What do they have? Icons. Ano yung icons? Windows into heaven. Windows into the heavens. At may historian icon. We cannot go into iconography now. No? Mahabang story. But they have icons, and their icons are not three-dimensional. Two-dimensional lang. That's why if you look at icons, medyo flat, di ba? Walang depth. Kasi nobody can make human form. But in the Eastern Church, in the Catholic Church, in the Western Church, in the Latin Church, we have images. Now, this is the Greek culture. Now, we cannot go into imagery and talking about images, but one thing I can say, in the Ten Commandments, you must not make images. Bakit? Because God has no image. But when Jesus Christ assumed human form, nagkaroon ng imahin yung Diyos. Kaya sabi ni Felipe, Philip told Jesus, show us the Father and that will be enough for us. And sabi niya, have you been with me all this time, Philip, and you do not yet know the Father? He who has seen me has seen the Father. So Jesus Christ is the image of God. When he assumed a human form, nagkaroon ng image. But then again, in the Ten Commandments, yung sinasabi, graven images. Hindi naman graven images, yung mga idols. Idols. And yet, God himself tells, after he gives the Ten Commandments to Moses, 5 chapters later in Exodus 25, what does he say? You make you create a box of acacia, inlay it with gold, and put images of 2 cherubim dun sa taas. Images yun. Oh, God himself telling him to make an image. And what else? What did he say? In the book of Numbers, Solomon, when he built his temple, God told him to have images of bulls and angels and everything and flowers. Yung mga images yun. Okay. What about Kwan? When they were in the desert, because of their stiff-headed, matigas ang ulo ng mga Israelita. That's why they wandered for 40 years in the desert. Parang mga Pinoy. Okay? Matitigas ang ulo. So, God sent sarap serpents. And they were beaten by the sarap serpents. Bakit sarap serpents ang tawag doon? Who knows? Masarap ang kagat? Sarap means burning. Burning. Yung kagat nila, burning. Masakit, mahapdi. Sarap serpents. It comes from the same Greek word as seraphim. Ano yung seraphim? The burning ones, the ones closest to the throne of God, seraphim, the highest of the angels, seraphim. So, sabi niya, okay, sabi niya kay Moises, you fashion a bronze serpent on a pole, and anybody who gets bitten by the serpent will just simply look at the serpent and he will be saved. He will be healed. So he makes a bronze serpent. Image yon, serpent pa. Diba, serpent is the one that tempted Eve in the Garden of Eden. And he fashioned a serpent on a pole, and anyone bitten by the snake would just look at the serpent and then he would be healed. Kaya yung serpent on a pole, that is also the symbol of the doctors. Hindi pag nagpareseta ka sa doktor, may serpent, di ba? Symbol ng doktor. Kasi pag siningil ka ng doktor, parang kagat ng serpiento din yun. Okay? So, what is the meaning of the serpent? That serpent in the New Testament is Jesus Christ. In the Gospel of John, Nicodemus goes to John, chapter 3. Nicodemus goes to visit Jesus at night. Nicodemus was a Pharisee, but he believed in things that Jesus said. Pumunta siya sa gabi para hindi siya makita ng mga tao na nagkukonsulta sa Panginoon. So he goes, and then Jesus says, you must be born again. I think you took this up in the sacrament, so I don't have to explain it. Born from above, born of spirit and water. And then the final words of Jesus there in chapter 3 is this. For just as Moses lifted up the serpent in the desert, so will the Son of Man be lifted up. And Jesus is lifted up where? On the cross. Why does the serpent represent Jesus? Who knows the answer? Why does the serpent point to Jesus? Why is the serpent on the pole in the book of Numbers, chapter 20? Why is it a figure of Jesus in the New Testament? Because Jesus, in assuming human form, ano yung serpent? Serpent means death. Serpent means poison. When you get poisoned, you die. You get sick. You're not perfect. Your body gets sick. Eventually, you die. Ano si Jesus? Jesus assumed human form. He had to conquer death. He had to conquer that sting of the serpent. He had to conquer that venom of sin in order to bring life back to its purity and even higher. Higher than when man was created in the Garden of Eden. So much so that we became higher than the angels. We will become higher than the angels. And St. Paul says in 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 3, do you not know that you will be judging angels? We will be judging angels. Huhusgahan natin yung mga anghel sa langit. When we're in heaven, in that final judgment, those who are living in Christ will be judging also the devils who will be sent to hell. So yung nagtutorment sa yung demonyo sa buhay na ito, pwede mong sabihin sa kanya, go to hell. Diba? Go to hell. So, sa images yun, I got sidetracked there. Okay. May tanong doon? Old Testament, imagery, nothing? Okay. So, the image represents death and man being dead. Sabi nga ni St. Paul, he is the firstborn from the dead. Why? Because human form, humanity is dead because of sin. But Christ, by dying to sin, by dying on the cross, he resurrects and he conquers sin. That's why St. Paul can say, oh, death, where is your sting? Where is your sting? Nasaan yung power mo? Okay. Kay Kwan, kay Calvin, naniniwala sa, mayroon siyang 5 points of the Calvin doctrine. Why I'm pointing out to you Calvinism? Because you will see, yung mga heresy ni Calvin, lalabas din sa mga kailala natin, mga born again, na iniiwanan nila yung Iglesia Katolika para pumunta doon sa born again because they think they have found the true faith. Calvin believed in total depravity, like Luther, meaning, when Adam and Eve committed sin, totally depraved na. Sira na, bulok na. It's like yung isang saging o mangga na bulok. Hindi mo na makakain yon. Bulok na yan. There's nothing you cannot restore it to its edible form, di ba? Edible state pala. Totally depraved. There's nothing that man can do. He's totally depraved. Wala, nothing. Then, he believed, tulip yan, ang conditional election, meaning our election to be redeemed does not depend on anything that we do. It doesn't depend on my free will. Wala tayong magagawa. It's only the grace of God, which is true. Sola gracia. Even our free will has nothing to do with it. Doon siya medyo wala. Mali, kasi yung free will has nothing to do with it. It cannot, man cannot, when he is totally depraved, there's nothing he can do to rescue himself out of it, which is true. But by the grace of God, we have the free will to accept Jesus Christ. When we accept Jesus Christ, we can come out of that wretched state, di ba? Then limited atonement. Para sa kanya, limited atonement, yung ibig sabihin nun, when Christ died on the cross, it was only for the elect. Limited. Bakit? Kasi sabi niya, yung iba pupunta sa impyerno. The rest will go to heaven. So Calvin believes in predestination. Yung predestination niya is this. Some will go to heaven, others will go to hell. Others will go to hell. Anong klaseng Panginoon naman yung... Why will God create man just to send him to hell? Di ba? Why will God allow an infant to be born, raise up, and then send him to hell? But according to Calvin, because we're already damaged goods, pinili na lang ng Diyos kung sila sino yung isasalba niya at dadalhin sa langit. Yan. Limited atonement. And then there's irresistible grace. Ano irresistible grace? You cannot resist the grace of God. Pag tinawag ka, if God chooses you cannot resist His grace. Kasi tinawag ka and you're elect and you're predestined, sigurado sasama ka. Perseverance of the saints. What is perseverance of the saints? Once you have accepted Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior, nothing can happen to you. If today I say, I have accepted Jesus Christ as my personal Lord and Savior, and I make my altar call, and then yung kapitbahay ko, linason ko, and then binenta ko yung alahas ng biyanan ko o ano o pinatay ko ng isang kaibigan ko, that means walang kwenta yon. It has no bearing on my being selected already by Christ to be saved. That is perseverance of the saints. Now, there was another reformer by the name of Jacobus Arminius. And if you go to certain Protestant sects here in the Philippines, like for instance CCF, yung mga ibang turo nila doon is against Arminianism. Who was Arminius? Arminius disagreed with, he was also a reformer, a reformer. He was a Dutch reformer, and he disagreed with Calvin on total depravity. Lahat yan. Para sa unconditional election, sabi niya, man's free will can work here, cooperate with grace. In limited atonement, sabi sa kanya, general atonement. The death of Jesus on the cross is general for all man, for all Christians, sabi niya. Kay Calvin, limited lang to those chosen to go to heaven. Yung predestination niya. Irresistible grace. You can actually, sabi ni Arminius, you can actually resist the grace of the Holy Spirit. If you do not want, you can resist actually the grace of God. There's some Catholic undertones there. Diba? What is the sin against the Holy Spirit? The sin of the Holy Spirit is refusal of grace. When a person is living in sin, sabi ni Jesus Christ, all sins can be forgiven except the sin against the Holy Spirit. What is the sin against the Holy Spirit? The sin against the Holy Spirit is when a person knows that he is in a sinful state and refuses to do anything about that sin. Alam niya nagkakasala siya. If he dies in that state, kanyan, he cannot be forgiven. He cannot be forgiven here or in the next. Ano yung next life na yung forgiveness? Yun na yung purgatorio where man's works are tested. Diba? If they're like gold and silver, they refine through fire in purgatory. If it's hay and stubble, masusunog yan. I think you took that in your purgatory courses, no? Okay, next. So, yung perseverance of the saints, you can actually lose it. You can actually lose your salvation, sabi ni Arminius. But he was also a reformed theologian. So, let's go now. So, okay. Now, the church, we have the Pope and the Magisterium. The church is at the service of divine revelation and teacher. We defined that earlier. Sacred scripture and sacred tradition are the sacred deposits of the faith entrusted to the church. Entrusted, Dei Verbum 10. So, sacred scripture and tradition, the Magisterium safeguards the teaching of scripture and tradition. When I say tradition, that's the apostolic tradition. For Luther, the church is at service of scripture alone. Everything that they do there, even their hierarchy, their bishops, they're at the service of scripture alone. In liturgy nila is more of a ceremonial. It is just a ceremonial. It's like a prayer meeting wherein you just express your faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. They also have a Eucharist from time to time, but like we said earlier, it's consubstantial, di ba? It's not transubstantiation. Yung kay Calvin, it was a hierarchy of elders. Para kay Calvin, yan, si Luther, Katoliko pa yan. So, he removed everything that was not specified in the Bible. So, he removed, because it's in the New Testament, Jesus Christ did not talk about the altar. About an altar, what did he do? He removed the altar. He removed walang vestments. Ano pa? Mga imahen. Sacraments. All the tinawag niya ordinals yung sacraments. So, he took a step further into the Reformation away from Luther. And there, instead of having a liturgy, wala silang liturhiya, naging sermon-oriented sila. That's why if you go to a Protestant sect, nakapokus lang sa pastor, and puro sermon yan, mga dalawang oras na preaching. Isang oras. Okay. That's the makeup of the church. In the Catholic faith, we cooperate with grace. Our free will is at work. We have that concupiscence. Okay, baptism removes sin, but it does not remove the concupiscence. And our free will now fights with that concupiscence, and we cooperate with grace in order to temper our passions. Sabi nga ni Saint Paul, I do what I'm tempted to do what I do not like to do. For the Protestant, free will is nothing. God is in control. Your free will has nothing to do with it. You cannot control it. Once you just give yourself to Jesus, just open, even your acceptance of faith, that is from Christ. You have to accept it. For us Catholics, baptism is a regeneration. You're a new man. For the Protestants, it is only a sign of your faith. It is an ordinance. I have become Christian. Now I can be baptized. It is only an affirmation that you have faith in Jesus. It has nothing to do. It's more of a ceremony to manifest, to show that you have to show your faith. Pero sa atin, there's infusion of grace. We discussed this already, yung transubstantiation, so we go on. So, nangyari sa Reformation, nagkaroon ng mga branches. No? You have the right wing, mainline, denominational churches. Creedal faiths. What do you mean by creedal faiths? They have creeds. They have a may Apostles' Creed din sila. For instance, yung Lutherans. The Lutherans, even the most extreme left of the Lutherans, the Evangelical Lutherans, recite the Nicene Creed. It was a Nicene Creed which we recite every Sunday. We got to the point wherein we say, I believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. They also say that. I believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. Yung Catholic sa kanila, hindi capital C. To them, Catholic is universal because Christianity is universal para sa kanila. And universal Lutheranism in that case, in their case. And they acknowledge some sort of spiritual authority yung mga pastor nila at yung mga obispo. Okay. Yung left wing, ito yung mga radical sects, yung fiduciary faiths. Fiduciary faiths, that was mentioned by Father Cayo Estrada in one of the talks. Okay. Ito yung mga walang formal organization. They come together and they sing, they praise God, and it's a gathering where two or three or more are gathered in my name, there I am in your midst. That is the church for them. It's a gathering of the faithful. The left wing, radical said, they have no liturgy, they have no creed, they have no hierarchy. And many of those churches we see today. When I say churches, it's small letter C, no? And with quotation marks. And the non-Christian, the cults that evolved of the sect, yung non-Christian yung cult. Yung mga, when I say cults, yung cult is actually, you have to define it properly because a cult can mean a following of something sacred. For instance, the rosary is a cult of the Blessed Mother. Devotion to the Blessed Mother is started as a cult. But it is not a cult in the derogatory sense of the word. Okay? Pietal act. It's a norm of piety. It's a devotion. When we say cults here in the organization of churches, ito yung mga kulto, ito yung because of one person, that person is so charismatic and they follow that person, he forms his own church. And usually, cults are not Christian. Ano ibig sabihin? The cults are not Christian. They do not believe in the Trinity. If you do not believe in the Trinity, hindi ka Christian church. Okay, like Kibuloy, Son of God, di ba? You'll take that up to next week with Marville. And the Protestant culture is generally anti-Catholic, and we're going to see why they became anti-Catholic. And they're afflicted with a generic tendency to divide. Basta nagkaroon ng disagreement, divide. I don't agree with my pastor, I'll form my own church, I have the Bible, and I'll go on. So, this is the ecclesial profile of the Reformation that started in Europe. You have the denominational, creedal, and hierarchies, meaning the Lutheran churches. When you say denomination, that means another church. There is only one church, the Catholic Church. Yun lang yung iglesia. Iglesia, sabi ni San Pablo. It is only that I will build my church, Jesus Christ. 1 Timothy chapter 3, verse 15. The church is the pillar and foundation of truth. Which church is it? The Catholic Church. St. Paul doesn't say the churches. The church. What about the others? Denomination. Denomination means to rename. De. Nomene. Nomenere. Sa Latin. Name. De. From. From that name. So it's to rename. The Catholic Church is not renaming. The Catholic Church is not a denomination. It is the church. All the others na hindi umalik sa Catholic Church, denominational churches yon. When we say denominational churches, meron sila ng creed. I believe in God, like the Apostles' Creed, no? Like I mentioned earlier. And they have a hierarchical organization, a body of bishops and pastors. And you know. Now, what about the Presbyterian and Reformed churches? Ito mga presbyters, mga elders. They are Calvinist in theology, semi-denominational, semi-creedal, but many of them have lost that even the semi. They become independent sects. Ito yung mga sekta. They call themselves non-sectarian, pero actually mga sekta sila. They originated from the denominations. Mga sekta yan. Baptist, Congregationalist, Adventist, Millenarist, yung naniniwala sa 1,000 Year of Christ, the Pietists, Mennonites, etc. Ano yung mga Mennonites? Mennonites are like the Quan. Mennonites are like the Amish and the Hutterites. Amish at Quan. Yung parang they distance themselves from modern living. Mga descendants yan ng mga Anabaptists. They're so radically reformed na pati yung pagbibisis nila, kagaya ng mga sa medieval ages. They're so radical in their practice of the faith. They will not accept electricity. Wala silang mga radyo. Wala silang electricidad. Wala sa... Okay. Tipid sila sa Meralco. Wala silang kwan. Wala silang mga kotse. Hindi sila sumasayang nakakaritelo lang sila. Imagine if you're an Amish there in Pennsylvania. Of course, that started in kwan. That started in the U.S., in England. In the Dutch area in Holland, and then when they came to the States, naging mas extreme. Okay, imagine if you're an Amish or a Mennonite, you go to town to buy supplies. Nakakasakay ka lang sa karitela. Ano makikita mo yung may mga nakamotorsiklo, nakasakay sa kotse. And you're a let's say you're a teenager, then you're dressed in something out of the 18th or 17th century. And then you see yung mga kaedad mo, may cellphone, naka Nike rubber shoes, kumakain ng sorbete. You'll feel strange, no? And yet, they manage to maintain their style because for them, all those things can bring you out of your faith in Christ. They are that extreme that they were so anti-cultural, they will not have anything to do with modern things because it can lead you to sin. Okay. Next. Okay. We go to the English Reformation. Sino si Henry VIII? Henry VIII was the king of England who married his brother's widow, and he wanted to divorce his wife eventually because she could not produce a male heir for him. Hindi lang yan. Nakakursunodahan yung lady-in-waiting who was called Anne Boleyn. Anne Boleyn. He fell in love with Anne Boleyn. So what happened? He wrote the Pope. Now, Henry VIII carried the title Defensor Fide, meaning defender of the faith. Come in, Defensoris Fide, defenders of the faith. Defensor Fide. Why did he get that title? The one who gave him that title was the Pope. When Luther took away the seven sacraments, the five of the seven sacraments, Henry VIII came to the defense of the sacraments of the Catholic Church. And the Pope gave him the title, Defensor Fide. Today, that title still remains with the monarch of England. Queen Elizabeth carries the title, Defensor Fide. It's one of the titles of the English monarch. Okay? And during that time, Henry VIII wanted a divorce. ayaw pumayag kay Santo Papa. Ano ginawa niya? He decided to put the crown, the Church of England, under the crown. And ubispo naman, Bishop of Canterbury, natakot. And he gave his allegiance to the king and not to the pope. And then you have the martyrs, Saint Bishop John Fisher and Saint Thomas More. I mean, Saint Thomas More, when he was about to be beheaded, I am the king's royal servant, but God's first, di ba? God's first. So, ano yare? Thomas More, and then the Catholics were persecuted during that time. Henry still thought of himself as Catholic. And the mass in England was still Catholic. At that time, wala pang break. Hindi, wala pang total break. They were what we would call schismatic, like the Orthodox Church. Was Henry believed that he was Catholic? Para kay Henry, the Catholic Church has a Latin branch, it has a Greek branch, an Eastern branch. This will be the English branch, sabi niya, para sa kanya. So they're still Catholic para sa kanya. Then, with his death, oh, by the way, during that time, those who did not conform, especially the religious and the nuns, what happened to them? Kinumpiska yung church lands. Yung mga convent, kinuha ng mga kaalyado ni Henry VIII. Ano nangyari doon? These people became lords in the parliament. Kaya yung mga ibang kwan dyan, yung mga ibang manor sa England that now belong to the several of the lords and titled people in England actually came from the Catholic Church. Okay? So, after the death of Henry VIII, by the way, pinapugutan niya si Kwan, si Anne. After that, he had no male heir. And namatay siya. When he died, his daughter, Queen Mary Tudor, took over. House of Tudor siya. House of Tudor. Ano nangyari kay Queen Mary? Queen Mary was die-hard Catholic. Okay. She wanted to restore Catholicism in England. And at that time, there were still a lot of Catholics in England. So she reigned for 5 years. And she had Cromwell beheaded for treason. And she is called Bloody Mary, not because marami siyang pinapugutan. May mga pinapugutan siya, but it's not that much. She was called Bloody Mary kasi meron siya ng dinudugo siya lagi. Whenever she got pregnant, she would lose the child. She had a bloody one. Yung, like that woman in the gospel, di ba? She had an issue of blood, lagi siya dinudugo. And the doctors could not heal her. And then when she saw Jesus, sabi niya, if I can only touch the hem of his cloak, then I will be healed. Remember that in the gospel? Ganyan si Mary. She had an issue of blood. Lagi siyang nagmi-miscarry. She was married off in order to reconcile, in order to restore Catholicism in England. She was married off to Philip. Philip, anak ni Ferdinand of Isabella. Ferdinand and Queen Isabella of Spain. Sinong Philip yon? Philippines. Doon kinuha yung pangalan na Philippines. But he was a young man. And he was not able to share a child. With the death of Mary, he went back to Spain. So what happened? With the death of Mary, the one who took over was another Tudor. Yung half-sister niya na si Elizabeth I. During Elizabeth's era, during her reign, Elizabeth I, Mary, Queen of Stuarts, Mary of Stuart, Queen of Scots, was beheaded. Why? Because she was a rival to the throne. Pinsan niya yan. Who was she? She was the daughter of the sister of Henry VIII, who married the King of Scotland. She belonged to the House of Stuarts. the House of Stewards. And then eventually, because she was supporting Catholics, there was a Kwan that they kidnapped her, and then she was beheaded for treason. Although it is said that King Elizabeth I did not want to behead her cousin, but at that time, the English crown was under the control of the Cecil brothers. Basta kontrola na nila si Queen Elizabeth. Basta kung anong kwan, papapirma na lang kay Queen Elizabeth. Okay? Queen Elizabeth was more of a puppet queen, and she was very insecure. She was insecure maybe because her own mother was beheaded by her own father. She was insecure in the sense, but she lasted very long. And during that time, England became, and the influence of the continental reform, Edward VI, later on in his history, made the ordinal, Edwardian ordinal of 1552, wherein they drafted the Anglican Church, the rules and regulations, what made the parang preamble ng Anglican Church. And there it says that the crown, the head of the church is the monarch of England and not the Pope. And with Matthew Parker changing the rights, the rubrics of ordination, ano nangyari? They lost the apostolicity. Nawala yung apostolic line. So yung mga pari nila, hindi na naging valid. They were no longer valid priests. Until that time, they had valid priests. They had a valid mass. They had valid sacraments. But after Matthew Parker changed everything in order to conform to the crown, then nawala yung apostolicity. Those are the 39 articles creating Anglicanism as the state religion of England. In fact, in the Constitution of England, it says there that no Catholic can ever be a monarch of England. Up to now. Okay. So, after the time of Elizabeth, James the First was the son of Mary, Queen of Scots. Yun yung umpisa ng House of Stuarts. Okay? House of Tudor, House of Stuarts, and then House of Hanover. Yun yung houses that ruled England. By the way, yung ngayon, House of Windsor, yung House of Windsor, bago na lang yan. Actually, they are a house of Saxo-Coburg-Gotha. Saxo-Coburg-Gotha. Tatlong families in Europe yan. Mga Germanic families. Paano naging House of Windsor yan? During the First World War, there was a strong sentiment against the Germans in England. So King George renounced his titles to the lands and his Germanic titles, yung Saxo-Coburg-Gotha. And that, what did he do? Kasi German yan. The ruling family in England is German. Germanic yan. So what did he do? He changed his name to Windsor. Wala naman Windsor sa kwan. Wala naman Windsor na pamilya sa kwan sa England. He just chose the name Windsor because Windsor Castle was figured prominently in the history of the kings. Kaya ginawa niya House of Windsor. So Queen Elizabeth, she has German blood running in her veins. So you have the English people and they're ruled by Germans. Okay. So, see, James the First was the son of, actually, James the Fourth yan, or James the Sixth. But when he became king of England, he became James the First. First siya sa England, na James. What happened? During that time, after his mother was put to death, he was only 8 years old, kinuha siya, and he was raised up as Protestant and not Catholic. He became Protestant. So, yan, umpisa na gawin. Then later on, yung mga sumunod sa kanya, Charles the First was friendly to the Catholic countries. Not only that, the crime of Charles the First was, well, he was heavy-handed. Masyado siyang stricto. So, ano yung ginawa ni Juan? Ano ginawa ni Charles the First? he was difficult to deal with. So Parliament decided to do something about it, especially since he married a Catholic princess. He married a French princess who was Catholic. So para sa kanila, babalik yung Catholic. You know, there's so much hatred. At that time, there's so much hatred against the Catholic Church that everything, every lie, every exaggeration about the Church started in England, mostly in England. And it was spread all throughout the English-speaking world by the English. We'll go to that later. So, what happened? Charles I was beheaded for treason. After a battle, nahuli siya, and Oliver Cromwell had him beheaded. And Oliver Cromwell, for 11 years, there was no king of England. There was no crown. Who ruled England? The Parliament. And what was the Parliament? The Parliament was now controlled by Puritans. Who are the Puritans? The Puritans were like the separatists. They wanted to purify the Anglican Church. Kasi para sa kanila, they na-influensya sila ng mga turo ni Zwingli at ni Calvin that the Reformation is not yet complete. So para sa kanila, the English Church, the Anglican Church is Catholic. Sabi nila, we have to prune it of its quality. We have to remove all Catholic. If you go to an Anglican Church, may confessional, may Mama Mary, may crucifix, may baptismal font, may holy water font. You'd think that you are in a Catholic Church. So, sabi niya, Katoliko pa yan. So what did he do? the Cromwell was a Puritan. By that time, because Cromwell was a very victorious leader and general, what happened? He was able to rally the people around him. The Puritans controlled Parliament, and then they declared Charles I as a what? They had him beheaded for treason. For treason to the English people. So for 11 years, there was no king in England. Then later on, the monarchy was able to return in 1660. Ano nangyari doon? Charles II na, one of the descendants of Charles I. What did he do? He persecuted the Puritans and the separatists. Sabi niya, kung ayaw niyo tanggapin yung state religion, which is Anglicanism, you can go to Holland where it's Calvinist, or you can be executed here. Just leave this place. So what did they do? The Puritans went to Holland because that's reformed in Holland. And when they got to Holland, after a while, they decided to migrate to the United States, and they landed in Plymouth Rock. And then, as a matter of fact, last Thursday, Thanksgiving Day, the ones who started that were the Puritans when they landed in the United States. What were the first things they did when they landed there? They robbed the graves of the Indians. Okay? Hindi nasasabi sa mga the popular historians sa history books. So, the Puritans were persecuted, so they went to England. Then, later on, several other Puritans and Calvinists went to the United States. So, pumunta din sila sa New World. Sabi nila, ayun, walang persecution doon. Kasi nagkakaroon ng persecution yung mga Dutch. No? So they went there. They arrived in what is now New York. And the ones from the Dutch colonies and the ones from Holland called Manhattan what? What? New Amsterdam. New Amsterdam. And then later on in the history of the United States, when more English-speaking peoples arrived, they called it New York. And then later, the Protestants came to the States. And then, okay, so in England, we talked about this, you know? And then from the Church of England, we get the Episcopalians. The Episcopalians are the American Anglicans. During the Civil War in the United States, and that Civil War, during the Revolution in the United States, yung mga obispo doon ng mga Anglican churches, because, you know, pumunta yung Anglicans, the Lutherans also went there, and then all, yung mga Anabaptists went there, yung mga descendants nila, yung mga Mennonites, Amish, at when they got to the States, the US, they decided to still go further away from the roots, to establish a pure religion, a pure faith based on the Bible. And then pag yung sa Anglicans naman, during the revolution, when the US was fighting for its independence, natakot yung mga English bishops, they went back to England. So when nawala na mga obispo sa US, what happened? The Americans, the Anglican Church, naging Episcopalian, they ordained their own bishops who were Americans. Yun, Episcopalian. If you go to an Episcopalian church, parang Katoliko din yun. Images, holy water font, you know. Okay. Then, of course, high, middle, low, and high church, middle church, low church. High church would be closer in traditions to the Catholic Church. Middle church would be more, may halong kwa na yan, may halong Calvinist or Reformed theology. Low church, yung mga extreme left yan. And then, from there, from this group, came the Methodists and the Salvation Army. Methodism. Most of the presidents of the United States came from the Methodist Church. In fact, Bush was a Methodist. I don't know about Khan, si Obama, but even Hillary Clinton, Methodist yun. Okay? Talo siya sa Presbyterian kay Trump. And the Methodist, ano yung ibig sabihin ng Methodist? The Methodist started as a cult, culto, a movement. A cult is a movement. Headed by John Wesley and his brother Charles Wesley. John Wesley and Charles Wesley were very religious. They were very close to the faith. They also believe in good works. Kaya method, the method of being Christian, Methodist. Yeah? So, in fact, this Christmas, this Advent season, kasi tinutugtog yung mga Christmas songs, one of the more popular Christmas carols that you will be hearing is Hark the Herald Angels Sing. That was composed by Wesley. John Wesley and his brother composed about 5,000 hymns. The Methodist Church is characterized by singing, mga hymnology. And from there, yung Salvation Army, yan. The works of the gospel, doing good works. Okay, and then of course you have the breakaway sect, yung mga sekta, separatists, Puritans, Anglo, and the Mennonites. We talk about then the Amish, the Quakers, di ba? Kumain ka ng oatmeal, may Quaker dan. No? Yung Quaker, tsaka Amish, at Mennonites, makikilala mo sila because they have a certain plan, they have a certain way of dressing. The Quakers, makikilala mo sila. The Mennonites and the Quan were very close. Closely related, the Amish. The difference between the Amish and the Mennonites is this. The Mennonites are not what are called the shunners. You shun other people. They were more open to other faiths in Mennonites. Okay. So, these are the eras of development of Protestant. 16th century, the Reformers, that is the birth of Protestantism. And with that, the birth of the Protestant traditions. Yung mga Protestant, may mga tradition din sila. It's all man-made traditions. It's not Catholic tradition. When you say sola fide, sola scriptura, that is a man-made tradition started by Luther and Zwingli and Melanchthon. So that these are the Lutheran traditions, the Reformed traditions of Calvin, Zwingli, and Melanchthon was closely allied to Luther. In the 17th century, this was the birth of Puritanism. Ito na yun mga, they wanted to purify the church of its Catholic identities or its Catholic influences. So they say, yung mga descended from the Anglican Church, para sa kanila, the Anglican Church is still parang Catholic Church pa. So they decided to strip it all of its Catholic vestiges and naging dumating yung mga Puritans. And the Puritans are of Calvinists, mga Reformed. Calvin was the main champion of the theology of the Reformed tradition. Arminianists, ito yung mga Arminians, kontra ito kay Calvin on the five points of Calvinism, yung tulip, which I explained earlier, and of course the separatists who wanted to separate further from the church. They were like the Puritans. So that's the 17th century. Then, in the 18th century, there were the revivalist traditions. Because of the church, kasi yung US pioneering spirit yung mga kano eh. They had to establish territories. They went to conquer the entire United States, which was at that time occupied by the American Indians. Punta sila, established colonies here and there. And with them, they brought their Bible and they brought their Protestant traditions. Kung saan sila nag-establish ng religion, then they will establish. And they brought with them the influences. So they got influenced by Luther, they got influenced by Tinsdale, by Zwingli, all those influences, and they were going to reinvent their own church. So they brought their, because of the diversity, in the 730s to 740s, the evangelical zeal, there was what was called the first great awakening. Actually, that started in Europe, pero mas laganap sa America. The first great awakening. What is the first great awakening? We can compare that to yung kagaya na nangyari ngayon, di ba, yung charismatic movement. Okay, in their kwan, it is a kwan, it is a pious movement, it is a an expression of their belief in Christ. It is the expression of their championing the Protestant ideas of the Protestant reformers. So during that time, maraming sekta na na-develop. Kanya-kanya. Diba? Even in the charismatic circle, diba? Dito sa atin, nagkaroon ng maraming charismatics. But the difference is, with the charismatic movement here in the Philippines, Katoliko lahat yan. Diba? They believe in the Eucharist, they believe in the Pope, they go to the sacraments, they believe in the sacraments. It's just a method of expressing, of practicing the faith. Sa kanila, they're reinventing the church. They're establishing churches along the way. It started in Europe and British America. When I say British America, this was America was still a colony of Britain. Hindi pa sila fully kwan, hindi pa sila fully independent. They gained their independence in 1776. So, okay? So and then after the revolution, there were other movements. After the war, nagkaroon ng mga revival and they started drifting from the reformers' doctrines. Lumalayo na sila sa mga doktrina ni Calvin at ni Zwingli at ni Luther. And then they started reinventing their own doctrines, formulating their own doctrines. As a matter of fact, if you go to the history of the church, if you go to the history of the Protestant Reformation, if you go to the life of the history of Luther, Calvin, and Zwingli, you'll be surprised to find out that they were all devoted to Mary. Lahat sila, Luther, Calvin, Zwingli, were all Marian devotees. Calvin defended the perpetual virginity of the Blessed Mother. So did Zwingli. So did Luther. Mother of God, they defended that. Now, yung mga descendants nila, wala. Para sa kanila, si Maria is just another woman, just a vessel that Christ used, naging user pa yung Panginoon. Diba? So, and then, nag-umpisa na yung mga, where am I? Ginalaw mo ba? Okay. Okay, the second great awakening was later on, in the after the revolution, after the they got their independence later on, 1790s to 1820. And then somewhere there along the way, nag-umpisa na yung mga fundamentalist. Fundamentalism. In the Second Great Awakening. Then, revivalist movements, mga movements here and there, sa Mississippi, sa Georgia, sa Bible Belt of America. Pag-establish ng town, mag-establish ng church doon, that church will be different from the other town. Iba-iba. Iba-iba. That's why if you go to the United States in the Bible, iba-iba yung plan. But in the U.S., the most predominant now is the Baptist among the fiduciary faiths. And again, in the USA, all these movements made the Americans very deeply rooted in Protestantism. That's why there was so much antagonism against the Catholic Church in the United States. When Kennedy became president of the United States, the first Catholic president, tinanong siya, will your faith have a bearing in? That's one of the questions he was asked when he was president. Okay? Unfortunately, Kennedy was not a very good witness to the faith. Next. So, These are the mainline creedal denominations. May creed sila, may hari. Anglicans, Episcopalians, Lutherans, and Sister Churches. High Lutheran, Middle Lutheran, Evangelical Lutheran, then the Methodists. Then the splinter groups, ito na yung mga yung, naging mga sekta. And it's only in the splinter groups, doon yung hardline animosity against the church. After Vatican II, there was good dialogue between the Lutherans and the Catholic Church, and also the Anglicans. As a matter of fact, 3 weeks ago, during the celebration of Luther's Day, which is October 30 or 31, Pope Francis went to Sweden to pray with the Lutherans. Can you imagine? Celebration of the Lutherans and Pope Francis is there. What happened then? Ang ganda na nangyari because the focus was on the Pope. And he was talking about unity. And it was it became an ecumenical gathering. And the Lutherans were also talking about unity. Next year, 2017 will be the anniversary of the Protestant Reformation, 500 years. Pope Francis is going to Germany to be with the Lutherans. Okay? And between the Lutheran Church and the Catholic Church, nagkaroon na namang agreement on sola fide at sola scriptura. They're already talking points and we're moving. We're edging closer to union. So that's one thing we should pray for. Union. Union. With the yung Anglicans na ang lapit sa atin. But what happened to the Anglicans was when they named a female bishop and an openly gay bishop to the Quan. What happened to them? One third of the priests of the Anglicans, one third of their clergy went to the Catholic Church. And now many of them are priests in the Catholic Church. And they had a special dispensation on, because mga married clergy yan eh. Yung kwa naman yung pare hindi nag-aasawa, it's a discipline in the Catholic Church. Among the Orthodox, meron silang married clergy. Why is it's a discipline? So in order that you can devote more time to your parishioners, to your congregation, hindi divided yung attention mo. Naku, kinakapos ako para sa tuition. Naku, second collection tayo mamaya. Okay, so that's what happened. So he'll go there, and it will be, will you pray for that event? Because we're edging closer to reunification. Okay. So from Europe, it spread to the colonies, and especially in the USA, alam mo naman, Yankee inventiveness, kung ano-ano yung ginagawa. So, naging generic yung Christianity. And if you go to the US now, there are some Americans who will say, I don't like this church, I'll go to that church. It's like a kwan, naging commodity ba? Naging commodity, I don't like this brand of car, doon na lang, yun na lang yung bibili. Hindi na faith. And they say they're kwan. Ito na yung umpisa ng mga mega churches. How can that be the church? Well, we're united in spirit. Yes, you're united in spirit, but being a member of the church is like marriage. You must be united in body and soul. If you're united, you're not united as one, you're united in spirit on some doctrine, you're not the church. Hindi yan si simbahan. Okay? So, we go now to the next. What happens? Today, they are categorized into, yung mga sects natin would fall under Baptist, that's the karamihan, the assemblies, the kahal, the ecclesia, the assembly of God. And fiduciary faith, yung faith alone. They just depend on, basta I have faith, I'm a member of the church. Okay? Then, in the revivalists, among the revivals, they're now grouped into fundamentalists, Pentecostals, evangelists. Ito yung general categories ngayon. What do we mean by when we say fundamentalists? These are the ones who hold to the fundamentals of the faith. Fundamentals of the faith, yung Christ was born of a virgin birth, the atonement of for sins, the inerrancy of sacred scripture, and two others. Nagsisenior ako, so it's not here at the moment. Anyway, Who are the Pentecostals? The Pentecostals are those who are masaya, rowdy. They're very, they love to sing, they love to dance. They can swing from the chandeliers in their prayer meetings. And they love to say, praise the Lord, brother, you pray. Exuberant sila. Praise the Lord, praise God. Oh, Holy Spirit is with you. Masaya sila. Then they dance, they sing, they're very movement. And para sa kanya, they exhibit the charisms of the Spirit as the way it happened in, they're trying to relive Pentecost. Ito yung Pentecostals. Now, evangelicals, these are the ones who are closer to the gospel. They try to live the gospel. Also, they all try to live the gospel, but there's a difference. The fundamentalists will not have anything to do with anybody. Fundamental sila. They're anti-cultural. Yung iba nga ayaw sumaludo sa bandera because you only rise up for God. You do not salute the flag because that's an idol. They're like that. They will not associate with, but they will associate with Pentecostals and Evangelicals, but they're very, they have a deep disgust for Catholics. They don't like Catholics, itong mga ito. For them, Catholics are damned, going to hell. The Pentecostals are more friendlier to the Catholics, especially because of the charismatic movement. So you can see now, even charismatics from Catholic communities and Pentecostals praying, singing together, praise songs in a community. But you have to be very well versed, very well grounded on your faith when you're there because that is a chance for you to evangelize. Kasi sila, kumahata ka nila, hahatakin ka nila. So that is the Pentecostals are friendlier to the Catholic Church. Okay? The friendliest ones to the Catholic Church, and they're not anti-cultural, and they believe in church history, are the evangelicals. Evangelicals. Ito na yung mga, they call themselves Christian. The Christian, naging Christian na si Juan. Naging Christian. Well, I tell my friends, na when you say naging Christian, that means umalis sa Juan, naging Protestant Christian. Because that Catholic Church is the true Christian Church. So it's characterized by evangelism and individualism and righteousness. I'll go through this briefly and then we'll have our Q&A. Wait, next. So the cults, the Mormons, ito na yung mga, they don't believe in the Trinity, okay? Ito, bukas, next week, si Kibuloy, ang dating daan, ang kabilang daan, ang daan sa ibabaw, ang daan sa ilalim, yung lumilikong daan. Marwil na dyan, okay? next. Marami yan. Daming groups yan. Okay. The Protestant's version of history. Can I finish in 10 minutes? Just give me 10 minutes. The early church was the apostles and Paul. Very important si Paul sa kanila. If you go to a Protestant setting, the teaching is always on Paul. The communities. Ano yung communities? The church communities were like today's Christian, Protestant Christians. Wala silang talagang kwan. They were all parang free-range Christians, I'd call them. Apostolic fathers and church fathers are usually overlooked. They will have some teachings on Augustine, pero piling-pili. Pero they're ignorant about this. That's why whenever they go to studying the apostolic fathers and the church fathers, doon nila nakikita the Eucharist, the sacraments, lahat, confession. Then they become, many of the Protestant converts became to the Catholic Church, became Catholic because of the apostolic fathers. Yung paniwala nila, early church apostles, the communities which were groups of worshiping Christians, and by the time of Constantine made the church, the Christianity, state religion para sa kanila. Constantine issued the Edict of Milan in 1313 ba yan? And he said, this put a stop to all Catholic persecutions. Pero sa yung Protestant understanding was when Constantine made it a state religion, although he did not make it a state religion, he just allowed the Christians Catholics to practice the faith openly like the Jews. So when he made it, according to the Protestant tradition, the church fell into apostasy. Corruption set in and paganism. Kasi marami daw na mga pagans na not catechized, they entered into the Catholic Church. So what happened? Ano ginawa nila? They introduced their images, they introduced kung ano-ano, pagan. So they say that the church fell into apostasy. And what happened? The Dark Ages, the church of Paul and the apostles went underground and emerged only when Luther reformed the church. Dun lumabas sila. So what happened during the Dark Ages? It was the age of superstition and ignorance, sabi nila. During that time, you took this up in church history already. By the way, in the 13th century, the first university was established, and that was a Catholic university. The schools, the hospitals, the Dark Ages were not dark ages. The medieval ages were not one of superstition. It was an age of light. Because the light there was the child, Christ. And Christ was the light for the world. And the church championed Jesus Christ at that time. So it was the spread of the gospel, the spread of the teaching of the people, the establishment of universities, hospices, and hospitals. So, Thomas, 13th century. He was a student of Gregory the Great. Anyway, and Thomism. St. Thomas was, you had to mention Thomas. Thomism was, Thomas took the ideas of Aristotle and the thought process and molded it into Catholic theology. Okay, next. So, and the misconceptions of the church. I think you took this already in church history, no? That the church changed the Bible. The church changed the Bible kasi ninanakaw yung mga Biblia na, napakamahal ng Biblia. It had to be copied by hand. Yeah, chapter by chapter, page by page, word by word. So they had to chain it in the churches kasi ninanakaw. So that is true, chained, but not because the church did not ban us from reading the Bible. The church banned us from interpreting the Bible by ourselves. St. Peter says, no one is to interpret the Bible by himself. The church burned the Bibles, yes. All the translations that were erroneous were burned by the church so as not to spread heresy. And then the lies about the papacy, you will take this up in the next era. The Crusades, Inquisition, and Conquest of the Americas, the greed now of the conquistadores. And there's a lot of lies told about the Crusades and the Inquisition. The Inquisition is the inquest. The Inquisition was actually instituted by the church to protect those who were suspected of heresy. Kasi pag sinabi heresy, sunugin na yan. So the church established the Inquisition in order to protect those who are accused of heresy. Because the one who was burning them at the stake was the state. So the church sought to protect them. And in the Inquisition, those who were found as being heresies, these were the ones turned over to the state and were punished. But this is exaggerated. The Crusades, I was in a party one time, hosted by one of my Bible class members, and one of the converts who's been attending my Bible study came with three of her nephews and nieces. And one of them, she's a young girl. She belongs to she goes to CCF with her parents. And she was asking things about the church. I said, what about the Crusades? What can you tell about this? Say, para sa kanila yung Crusades, the Catholic Church murdered innocent men, women, and children during the Crusades. Sabi ko sa kanya, the Crusades, if not for the Crusades, sabi ko, you would be Muslim today. You would not be wearing shorts. You would be wearing a kwan, and maybe you cannot go out. You're married to some Muslim, sabi ko. If not for the Crusades, all of Europe would have been Muslim. Because the Crusades brought the war to that area. So, yun nangyari, they were stopped dead there in the Middle East. They could not proceed. So even if they had already infiltrated Europe, as a matter of fact, Spain was under the Moors for 700 years until the House of Castile and the House of Aragon merged. Catherine of Aragon, Isabella from the House of Aragon, and Ferdinand from the House of Castile married, and the two houses were merged. And then the last stronghold of the Christians at that time was already in Santiago de Compostela, and from that, in fact, 2021, 5 years from now, we're going to celebrate 500 years of Christianity, and we can trace our apostolic line from sino? Which of the apostles? St. James. Well, St. James planted the cross in Spain and Portugal, in the Iberian Peninsula, and then the cross was brought here. So yung mga kaparean natin can say that they can trace their fatherhood to St. James the Apostle.